How's it going? Hopefully all is well with you and yours. It is a beautiful day here at the meeting place of heaven and earth. I just got done doing some sunbathing and I wanted to show off my garden. I didn't completely finish it, but I created this little patch over here to plant some corn. As you may be able to see, I transplanted the corn that I planted in a container over there, and I also planted some new corn, so we will see how that goes. As you can see, my wall is flourishing. If only I knew what these plants even were. I haven't really even looked into it, so. I also planted some sunflower seeds here, but I've noticed the past few days that some of them have been eaten. So we'll see what actually comes through in the end. Can't be too mad. This is a birdie paradise, and they love sunflower seeds, so yeah. Look at my babies! Yay! As you can see, some of them are blooming and looking beautiful. Speaking of blooming, let's go look at my onion over here. Look at these. Growing potatoes is beautiful. It's exciting. It's something that you can be proud of. Growing animals so that you can kill them, enslaving them so you can consume their byproducts. That's not beautiful, that's ugly. Here's my beautiful cherry tree getting watered. Look at that. I don't know about you, but I have never seen a more beautiful blooming onion in my life. And you can see my cherries are coming in. Many of my apple trees are producing delicious looking apples already. I think I saw some pears over here too. Yum. Yesterday afternoon, I went to Berryvale in Mount Shasta to get some groceries for my full moon event, and I was stopped at the door, and the guy asked me to put on a mask. I find it to be unbelievably offensive for someone to ask me to cover this up. And I'm not going to do it. Not just because I'm a narcissist, but because there are health risks associated with you literally suffocating yourself. So after he asked me to put on a mask, I was upset about it because, like I said, it's unbelievably offensive for someone to ask me to cover up my face. So I just left. But unfortunately, I really needed the groceries, so I went back later towards closing time, and I waited in line. And when I walked up in line without a mask on, the lady in front of me took hers off, and a few other people actually came and stood in line without masks on as well. They were feeling courageous because they saw other people not wearing masks. Then all of a sudden the guy at the door is saying, "We've got four people out here unmasked," like we're terrorists or protesting being masked. And they basically said that anyone with a mask can go through and not wait in line. So there were a few people that decided that they would put on masks, but about four of us continued to keep our masks off and just waited until we were allowed to go in breathing freely. So I was thankful that I was able to get the things that I need for my event. And yeah, I won't be wearing a mask in the future. There are health risks, and my medical privacy is guaranteed by the law. So. In various cities across the United States on June 21st, were planned so-called Luciferian marches in support of the New World Order. The closest city to me that was promoting this event was Salem, Oregon, so I made the 5-hour drive with the intent of interviewing the people that were organizing the event and asking them why in the world they would support the New World Order. I also ultimately wanted to go to bear light in the darkness and correct them to let them know that Satan and Lucifer are not the same entity. I grew up in mainstream Christianity and I was heavily indoctrinated to think that Lucifer and Satan are the same entity, that they are interchangeable nicknames and all of that. But in reality, they are pretty much literal opposites. On one hand, you have Lucifer, who is that's a nickname for Venus, goddess Venus, when she rises before the sun bearing the light. She is the light bearer. She purifies humanity. She bears the light in the darkness that Satan has created. And on the other hand, you have Satan, who is a male. He is a djinn. He is the corrupter of humanity. He literally turns humans into clowns, okay? Whereas Lucifer is here to stop humans from being clowns with the knowledge that she gives them. She sheds light in the darkness and says, "Hey, you guys are acting like clowns." But of course, Satan has confused the issue. Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light, a bearer of light, a Lucifer, in order to lead people astray. And boy, has he done that. Nowhere in the Old Testament or New Testament is Lucifer identified with or as Satan. This confusion was done on purpose. If you have spent any amount of time questioning the things that you were taught, you will quickly find out that almost everything that we have been taught is an inversion of the truth. What is good has been labeled bad, what is bad has been labeled good, and vice versa. Someone might say, "Oh, well, then that means that Satan's good because he's labeled bad, right?" Oh, okay. Well, if you're a human and you are cheering for Satan, you're a clown. Because Satan is literally contracted to corrupt humanity, Satan deceives humanity, and Satan turns humans into clowns. So one of the dumbest things that you could do as a human is to cheer on Satan. So yeah, that's what I kind of wanted to go and say to some Luciferians at so-called Luciferians at these events. Most of them, from what I can tell, are just confused and they lean more on the satanic side of things where they, "Oh, well, God didn't want us to have knowledge and Satan gave us knowledge and love made everything better." It's that is not the case. If you look around this world and see how deceived humans are, see the level of degeneracy in this world, and how sad and pathetic humans have become. They've become clowns, embarrassing to their own souls. And that is Like, because Satan is in charge of our world. And together we can change that. There was one person who gave me a Hail Satan type of hand gesture when I got there. I think that she was trying to, you know, communicate with me, but I'm not a Satanist, so I didn't do it back to her. And I did end up talking to her for a while. She's really nice. But we definitely were not on the same page about who Satan is. And as you'll see from the footage, the majority of the people that were there were actually Bible thumpers. And they were pretty much, well, as you can see, I was walking around in black and they were pretty aggressive about, you know, hey, are you here with this group? Like, so... yeah, anybody that did come for the actual event to support it when I wasn't there, I'm sure that they got quickly run down. If they were even confident enough to go up there in the first place, the Bible bashers were all standing in a circle right on the Capitol building stairs. So it was kind of a little bit intimidating for most people, especially those who... call themselves Luciferians, but are actually Satanists. Those who, you know, oh, we hide our magic because we're doing bad things and we're worshiping Satan type, you know. So, yeah. Without further ado, let us get into the footage from the Luciferian event. So I am here in front of the Oregon State Building, and... none of the people from the Luciferian organization that are actually planning this event actually showed up. The only people that are here so far, well, there are one or two stragglers, but the only people that are here are these Jesus cultists that are giving testimonies or something over there. So I'm not gonna go over there. I'm gonna go and get something to eat and come back in a little bit and see if anything has happened. I am going into the space here, which is a vegan restaurant, to see what kind of delicious food that they have. For dinner tonight, I went to a place called The Space. And this is the first cooked vegan meal that I have had in 15 days, I think. And it was channeled to me that they are vegan master chefs, so I really needed to try something from their menu. So what I ended up ordering is this house-made chickpea cheeseburger with some caramelized onions and some tater tots on the side. And for dessert... they had vegan donuts! Some cinnamon sugar donuts, and those other ones are blueberry Pinot Noir of some sort. And I actually got some free donuts because somebody actually stole my order. The owner took it out to a car and said, "Is this your name?" They said, "Yes," and they took my food and left with it. So... thankfully, they gave me some free donuts, so hopefully they're good. All right. That is really good. I really like the flavoring of that. Let's just try a bite of dessert because it sounded like a dog. Earlier I was at the gas station, I was coming out of the bathroom, and I looked in the parking lot and saw this guy that kind of looked like a pirate running across the the parking lot chasing after this German Shepherd dog that was sprinting across the parking lot to just attack this other dog. I'm not sure what kind of dog it was, but it was getting its butt handed to him. And I was seeing this happen in slow motion. I'm like, oh my gosh, what's happening? But thankfully the owners pulled each other's dogs off of each other, and they were actually threatening each other. The one said, "You better watch out, old man. You better watch your back." It's like, wow, that's intense. Okay, anyways. Yum. I haven't had a good vegan donut ever. Besides for this. The other donuts that I've had were okay, but they were cake donuts, and these are not. This is delicious. I'm really glad that I got extra. Look at this massive joke. Amongst the statues that should come down in this country, stupid things like this, pseudoscientific jokes on humans should be taken down. This, believing that you live on a giant spinning ball, makes you a clown. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be a clown. So, you should research everything that you have been taught, because nearly everything that we have been taught is an inversion of the truth. If you really think that you are living on the top of the ball, and people are living on the bottom of the ball upside down, and a magical force is holding billions of gallons of water to this giant spinning ball as it whirls and twirls through space, congratulations, you have been successfully deceived.
So are you guys part of the group that didn't show up, or what?
I'm actually from Mount Chad.
Well, if they did show up, we walked all around. So, do you know what
well,
the.
Say this, you
can have the notes. Well, maybe they're going to be here tonight. One of their websites says that they're going to go until 11 o'clock.
I think that is what I saw.
So, are you a Wiccan like or what? Event.
No, Wiccan is a religion. I don't follow any religions, so, yeah, I'm not really part of any mainstream religion, but I associate with the Essene Christ, not the mainstream version, but the Essene version that was against animal sacrifices.
Yeah, I'm very familiar with the Essene, so it's kind of a Gnostic side.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm very familiar.
Yep.
So yeah. No Baphomet, no Babylonian sort of stuff?
I think that Baphomet might be misconstrued, misunderstood, and it may have been a symbol of something, and then people jumped on the bandwagon to demonize it type thing. Like it was more of an occult symbology, and now Satan has turned into more of a Satan pride type thing, I guess.
Yes, now it kind of works.
Oh yeah. Well, I don't agree that Satan and Lucifer are the same entity.
You don't tell me about that. Pretty little bit. Can you tell me?
Lucifer comes from Luciferi, which was originally a nickname for Venus when she rises before the sun, bearing the light. And Satan has demonized Lucifer and confused the whole issue of the two, making evil good and good evil, essentially. And he masquerades himself as an angel of light to lead people astray, so he's kind of taken on this whole, oh, I'm Lucifer, look at me, I'm like here, type thing, and tricked a lot of people into doing really horrible evil, especially with the Baphomet. It's like a really associated with child abuse, unfortunately. Sexual child abuse and just sacrificing your kid to Satan. So that's unfortunately what the statue and all that have taken over. But I kind of tend to think that they might have had different original meanings that weren't so evil.
Well, Lucifer is actually a biblical much different than name and concept. And that's where it comes from, the light bringer. The Bible itself makes a connection between Lucifer and Satan.
I would disagree with that.
I'm just telling you what the Bible says.
Well, I actually grew up as a Bible thumper, so I've been through all this. And I used to think they were the same, but actually nowhere in the Old Testament or the New Testament is Lucifer associated with or identified as Satan.
I
and before 19... 1967, I think, it was only used for female deities.
So what is it that you created?
Well, first, I know that we were created by goblins. We live in an enclosed realm, not on a giant spinning ball flying through space. Genesis 1 talks about how the firmament is over top of us. We live on a stationary plane. God,
you're
flat
earther.
I am a flat earther. The Bible says multiple times that the earth does not move. It has four corners. Satan tells us that we live on a giant spinning, meaningless ball whirling around space. So, yeah, that's kind of where I started. I still believe in God, but I don't subscribe to any religion because I think that Satan has perverted.
Are you searching?
I don't know what you mean by
searching.
So you say you believe that there is a God? I know there is. I wouldn't say believe,
okay,
I know
so
it.
You know there
mind.
Is a God.
Right.
Okay, so you think you believe that they're all been perverted by Satan?
Mainstream Buddhism, yes. Yeah.
Okay. So then,
I'm just curious.
What do you
think? Well, yeah, I mean, I think that there's a lot of truths that we still don't have. But the apocalypse means unveiling, and so all of these truths that have been hidden from us are now coming to light, and the deception is going away. Satan's deceived the whole world, and now we're finally realizing, you told us that we were evolved monkeys living on a spinning ball, and that's not true. We're actually center stage in God's creation. We were created as humans. We're not evolved primates. Like, that's where I'm at. But I don't.
Is it a reference from the Bible?
Correct. I think that there are truths in the Bible, but I think that there are untruths in the Bible. Satan likes to mix truth and lies. I agree that Jesus did teach us the way, the truth, and the life, how to get to heaven, but I don't believe that God required innocent sacrifices, innocent bloodshed to forgive us. Oh, I disagree.
It was just a pocket.
Oh, for Jesus, you mean? Oh, well, I'm saying, like, before that, before even, like, in the Old Testament, I don't think that God ever requires innocent bloodshed to forgive us. Ever.
So the only thing that matters right now, though, is that Jesus is the one. Not the other stuff that matter now.
I think that the truth of everything
is.
I don't want to be covered in any of these. That's Satanism where I want to be. I want to be pure and clean. I don't want to be in any innocent bloodshed, so that's why I'm vegan. I don't deal with innocent. God hates me and shed innocent blood. So I don't want to be covered in innocent blood or have anything to deal with. I don't believe that the original Christians believe that you just believe in Jesus and you're saved. I think that you actually have to be a good person yourself. You don't just say, oh, well, somebody died for my sins, so it's fine. I just think Jesus said be perfect, as God is in Christ. So then you can. It's very possible to do it. I try to make the decision that you make. It can either be a perfected decision and make you a better person, or lead you in the direction that Satan wants you to go. I move in the direction that God wants me to go. I'm a purifier. I'm a purist. I want to do what I know in my soul is right, so that when I get to heaven, I can say, God, I made those decisions in my life, and I stand by them, because I did what I thought was right.
So you're a self-appointed attorney?
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be better if we have God as yourself as your attorney?
I think that God judges righteously. See, God is a judge, not the
attorney. Okay, be your attorney. You will judge.
Well, I don't subscribe to that religion anymore.
But it's not a religion.
But it is.
It
says I came
Bible,
from it. I used to say that I don't.
It says you're pure as snow, white as snow.
Yeah, and I strive for that, but I do it by my own actions. Because I was raised in the Christian cult, and I was surrounded by people that said that they were different, that claimed that they're saved, and all this stuff. No different than the world. They're still eating incense. They're still celebrating pagan holidays. They're still doing this and that. So, like, there's no difference, really, between you and the other, not you, but the mainstream Christians and the other people of the world that I see. So I couldn't be a part of the mainstream Christianity.
So you think you're an angel?
No, I know I'm not an angel. Angels are beings of light that are created by God. They're just going to lie back. They're human bodies. But Jesus says, be perfect as your Father is perfect, so if he commanded
you have to
get the course. Yeah, it's a journey. But he says that he tells you to do it, so what he commands you to do something that's not walking around. It's possible through his spirit to make him realize. Do you have spirits within you?
Well, I think that the spirit of truth is a little bit different. I see the Trinity as a little bit different than mainstream Christians, I think.
So.
I think the original Trinity was a father, a mother, and a child, not just three guys. So it was more of a balanced thing.
So what are the wages? The wages of sin is what?
Death.
Does everybody die?
Technically, yes.
So then we all have sin.
Yeah.
We have sin.
I mean, I have not lived a perfect life. Up until about 3 years ago, I consumed animals and their products and made a bunch of sins. So it's a daily process
you think you're going to die without a sin?
I would like to, but probably not. I mean, it can be perfect, and I try to be, but it's, I mean...
The wages of sin is dead.
Everyone's going to die.
We all have sin.
Everyone's going to die.
Exactly. So we all have sin in our lives.
Correct, because we've all said lies, we've all eaten animals, I disagree. Babies are born perfect.
No, they're not.
I disagree with that completely. A baby is more perfect and has done no sins until it is trained, until it is influenced by Satan's society to do evil.
But they were created man and a woman by intercourse, so they come out sick. I'm not saying sex is sinful.
But that doesn't make sense because the Bible says be fruitful and multiply. So how is that going to be sinful?
It's not.
How is having sex and having a baby make them
you're
sinful?
You're twisting everything.
No, I did not. You said because they had intercourse and had a baby, then that means sex. Sex equals intercourse, just so we are all on the same page.
All people are fallen from God until they're reunited to His family.
Well, I used to believe Jesus.
You don't believe in Jesus?
I believe in Jesus, but I do not believe mainstream Christian beliefs about
him. Do you believe that Jesus is God?
Jesus said, ye are all gods. And that's actually what Psalm says as well. If you want me to pull it up, it's in John. No, it says, does your prophets not say ye are all gods? I got you, don't worry. Psalm 82 and John 10, ye are gods. So it actually says it in Psalm 82 first, and then John 10, Jesus quotes. So is it not written in your law, I have said ye are all gods?
What translation is that?
I mean, we can look at the KJV if that's what you want. I used to be a KJV only Bible thumper too. Ye are gods. I mean, it says it right in your Bible twice.
Are you sure that's a real Bible?
Do you want to grab your physical Bible and look it up? Do you have one? Because it's in. Does anybody have a physical Bible? John 10:34.
I have a Bible.
Right.
Thank you. Can you explain that?
Yeah. They're twisting things around.
What's your name?
My name is Inarma, and I'm not twisting
anything.
Keith,
nice
to meet you.
Yeah,
no, she's right. Let's see what it is. Well, the Bible does say that the saints will judge the world, but I'm not sure that that's what
it
says.
It does say they're going to judge the world. And the reason why he says they're going to judge the world is because the real saints of God will not be silent. We will always stand up for righteousness. We will always stand up for what belongs to God and what is of God. That's what real saints are. And it's time for us to do our part. If you're a believer in Christ, you need to start doing your part. Revival is here. Now let's pick up our shoes, put them on, and get out of there in the streets, and hit the hedges and byways like God told us to.
Amen.
All I just say is that if you're going to speak to this woman, do not be divisive with her. She may have information, do not take it all unless if it comes, unless it goes word by word with God. That's right, brother. Don't be divisive.
Well, I follow the Essene Christ, not the Bible on the eight fish and
I just want you to know he loves you.
So here is actually the Hebrew word. You can go to John 10:34 interlinear Bible, and you can actually click on the word God. It says you are all gods, and it says God, a God, a God. Generally, properly, God, the creator and owner of all things. It actually shows you what the Hebrew word is. So it doesn't actually say anything about a judge. It actually says divinely God, 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 God-fearing, godly, godly.
I like that. God-fearing, godly, yes. That's
but pretty. We're all gods.
That's an interpretation because we're all called to be godly, God-fearing.
I agree with that.
After God. Those definitions of the word I agree
with. That's nice to talk to you. But I am thankful that I am no longer
the singing Christ. Is that like Gnostic Christ?
It is, yes, I'm Gnostic. So.
Okay, what does that mean exactly?
So the Essenes were like a sect of Jews. There was the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Essenes. And the Essenes kind of were against the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and they would say God didn't want us to murder animals, like, let's stop this, and they didn't believe that Jesus came to atone for their sins. They believe that Jesus came to show them the way to be better, because no one can atone for the sins of another person. Even the Bible says multiple times that no one can die for the sins of another. Like, you're going to be accountable before God for your own sins, and
yeah,
that's where I'm at, so I want to make sure that I do the best that I can do to be the best me that I can be, whereas I've been in mainstream Christianity, and I've seen my own family, and it's like they use this whole Jesus died for my sins as a crutch to live as they want and not be a better version of themselves, because why should they? Jesus died for my sins, so I can be the worst person ever, and then on my deathbed I can say, oh,
yeah.
So.
Okay, interesting.
So are you, like, with them, or are you, like...
My dad's here.
Okay.
His father's there.
Nice.
I was raised in it, you know, I'm still researching, I'm mostly being an observer in this thing, because I'm curious, but I've been looking more into Gnostics, or Gnosticism, and all of that, so
right.
I'm really curious what different people believe.
Right. It's unfortunate, because the Gnostic texts go into, they've been, Satan has touched them too, so it's like they demonize our creator. Our creator is
empty.
Like, if you look around... God, this is a paradise. This earth could be a paradise if Satanists weren't in charge of it. Like, they're the ones making it hell. God put us in a Garden of Eden. God is good. Like, he wanted a good for us. You know what I'm saying? But the Gnostic texts, unfortunately, take an anti-God kind of spin. So I've gone through that whole thing. So I would just caution anybody else, because our Creator doesn't want bad things for us. It's like... I'm very passionate about defending the Creator, because, I mean, this is a beautiful earth that we live in, and we can make it a paradise if these evil forces of darkness weren't working against us. And that's kind of why I was here. I'm against the New World Order myself, and I wanted to kind of see why these people are supporting it. Maybe they don't know what the New World Order is. Maybe they don't realize that Satan is anti-human and that is against all of us. I don't know. So.
What is the New World Order to you?
The New World Order to me is Satan's most oppressive system. It's like communist China, but like worse. The most awful. Have you heard of The Handmaid's Tale? It's a new movie, and or it's a new series, and it's like.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. I'm being Handmaid's Tale.
I think it's the same. Yeah, and there's like a destruction, chaos that happens, and then they come into this new world where they like make all of the women breeders, and if you step out of line, you get sent away to do work camps and all this evil stuff. Like, that is the direction that they are heading.
Okay.
Is like the most horrible, oppressive thing.
Like an authoritarian regime, kind of like how communist Russia was.
Yeah, yeah, but the worst yet. Like, they're very anti-human. Yeah.
For that matter. Yeah. Okay. Interesting.
Have you looked into the Georgia Guidestones at all?
No.
Well, the one thing is like maintain the world population. So it's like
there's a set limit that they want to make sure that humans don't go over. They're farming us like cattle.
So Georgia Guidestone, you said?
Yeah, the Georgia Guidestones. There's huge just pillars in Georgia with multiple languages written on them, the same thing, and it talks about depopulation literally written on the stone. It's pretty crazy.
Yeah, but it kind of sounds like the Club of Rome.
Right.
The whole humans are cancer thing.
Okay, I haven't looked into the Club of Rome, so I'd be interested in...
It was in the 70s, I believe. I've only looked into it a bit, but it was in the 70s, I believe, that a government group came together to combat global warming and whatnot. And
oh, really?
They were talking about humans as a cancer.
Right.
Because, you know, we tend to make aggressive things and all that.
Well, it's kind of funny, though, because it's like a baby will come out as a blank slate, and then the world and all of these influences will make that baby, you know, be raised the way that it is. So it's like humans don't have to be like this, but we're being programmed, we're being trained to be like this so that we become the worst versions of ourselves in every way. We trash the earth and very sad.
So you say blank slate. So, because I don't necessarily agree with that, so I'm curious.
Okay.
Like what you mean.
Like a baby kind of comes into the world not necessarily having any preconceived notions. It's like it doesn't necessarily act a certain way, but once it gets influenced by media and different culture and different influences, then it starts to behave a certain way. You know what I mean? I think that if you start with a baby and you treat them, you know, you treat them... You encourage them, yeah, with love, and you encourage them, and you say, you know, we don't litter, and you tell them why, and you tell them how to treat people and stuff, that they can be good people. Like, I think that's in our human nature that we want to be good. Like, kids, I think there are a few cases where they can be pretty evil, but in general, I think that they are kind and, I mean, sometimes have selfish issues, but we all do. At the end of the day, like, we have a self-preservation, like, I don't want to die, do you? God kind of made us a little bit self-preserved in a way so that we will take care of ourselves and survive.
Okay, interesting. So yeah, I don't believe in the blank slate for you, for my own.
Where would you place yourself on that then? Like, what do you mean that you don't think that... So would you think that... Well, first of all, do you believe in reincarnation? Do you think that we've done this before and that our souls existed before and that we're doing this again?
I don't know. And I don't think there's any way I could know. So that's one of those things, kind of like, I don't know if there's heaven. I don't know if there's hell. There's literally no way. That's where faith comes in. There's really no way of knowing. I don't personally subscribe.
What TV show or website is that?
I don't personally subscribe to reincarnation, but I haven't looked into it a lot, but it's one of those things that I just think it's impossible to know.
So then, why would you think that? I'm just trying to understand where you're coming from. Like,
yeah.
The babies wouldn't be like where are you coming from with that angle?
So. The reason I don't think they've come out as a blank slate is there's been a lot of literature done. I don't know if you say you don't believe in like evolution or anything, so I don't know if you read much scientific literature or if you're open to it or whatnot.
Yeah, I'm open to any truth regardless of where it comes from. And
there's a really interesting developmental psychologist named Jonathan Haidt.
Okay.
He's written some very interesting books.
Haidt, like H-E-I-G-H-T?
H-A-I-D-T.
Okay.
So like Haidt.
Okay.
But Haidt.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's strange.
The foreign name.
Yeah. I believe it's... he's from. But he's Russian.
Okay.
He's from Russia. In his book, The Righteous Mind, he talks... There were a lot of studies done. Because the point of the book is to discover, like, to explore the moral landscape.
Okay.
And so, the what one of the things they found is that children come out with like a sense of right and wrong. And so I don't see how, as well as personality, like, we all have different personalities. Which, no, I definitely agree. Your upbringing can shape so much.
Right.
That's why growing up in a loving household is one of the most important things. Or with loving people, right?
Right. Supportive.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. But we, you know, we all have different personalities. Some people are more mean, some people are more aggressive. But that can be changed. And babies are similar. You see little the word I want to use to include these into how they're going to be.
Right.
That's not the right word.
I think I know what you mean, because babies do have a little glimpse of their own personality in their actions. Yeah.
So that's what I mean by I don't think it's placed in. Do you mean...
No, I totally agree with you, actually, because I do think that we have a natural sense of what's right and wrong, and then when we're exposed to, well, essentially the satanic culture that we're in, that Satan wants to corrupt us that Satan wants to corrupt everyone, so all the media that we're all indoctrinated with is leading us towards that corruption rather than being good people, essentially.
Yeah, I kind of agree with the media's pretty corrupt.
Right.
Especially the mainstream media. Correct me if I'm wrong. So, I think what you mean by blank slate is there's an opportunity there to go either way. Not that there's just like, there old people used to believe that you could have a baby and it was blank. You could teach them anything. And that's kind of true.
I think we are on the same page, I do agree that we are born with that inherent sense of right and wrong. So, I mean, as far as a blatant slate goes, I do agree with that. Okay. But, I don't think that we have any disagreement on that part.
Yes.
I just think that a baby hasn't actually done any sin yet. So, it's like, and
not
plus, even most Christians agree that there's like an age of accountability. So, it's like if you die at 7 or something, and it's like there's an age that God's like, okay, well, you were ignorant, so you get a free pass.
The Torah puts that at age 20.
Really?
That's when he held the Israelites accountable for the sins. Anybody under the age of 20 couldn't go into the promised land. So there's a lot of grace there for people under that age who died before.
They couldn't go into the promised land.
They couldn't go because of, I should say, over the age of 20, they couldn't go into the promised land. Anybody under the age of 20.
I'm sorry. I'm confused. So you're saying that over could not go in, or over could?
Yeah, because of their doubt and unbelief. Because
the children did go in.
The children did go in because they were still innocent. Yeah, they hadn't. Yeah, exactly. So, they were able to go in because they were not. Their parents had doubt and unbelief about the spies' report going into the promised land, and they didn't believe. That's why they had to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. The children were under that. They weren't held responsible for that sin of unbelief, that lack of faith.
Right.
So they were able to go in.
So I think what you're saying is babies, for example, haven't had the chance, and young people haven't had the chance to be tested. And so,
I think they do get tested, but it's like they're kind of like really young, and plus they're under the influence of their parents, too. So it's like if your parents tell you one thing, then...
Your parents are God.
Yeah, they might be wrong. So it's like, I don't know. I don't really know all the ins and outs, but I think that God is a righteous judge and that he'll be like, okay, well, you were in this situation, so I'm going to judge you this way. Whereas this person, they grew up in a Christian home, so they knew their whole life. So they're going to be maybe judged a little bit harsher than someone who didn't know.
That's
at
very
all,
biblical, so. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay.
Levels of rewards and levels of punishment based on the level of light that you have and what you did with it.
Yeah, okay. And then the last thing I was curious about is you were saying that, because there was a lot that went on that people talk about, so I'm trying to like tried to make certain points in my head that I could remember to ask you about. So the other thing I wanted to kind of figure out what you meant by when you said that you believe that we're all gods. So do you mean that in like we're physically all gods, or we all have, because I believe that in the Bible it says we all have the spark of divinity. So do you mean that it's like we all have the potential to become good, if you will, and, you know, or we have the potential to turn the world into hell?
Well, that is very true. We do have the potential. But the Bible says in Psalm 82 and John 10 that we are all gods. So that's where the only reason that I'm quoting that is from that. And I personally do believe in reincarnation. I think that we have been through this before and that we've been over and over and over again many times. But I think there's one creator who created this. Like, we didn't all come together and say, let's create this together and it should be like this. And we all agreed. Like, that is ridiculous, because we wouldn't have all agreed on everything. But I do think there's one creator, but I think that souls did pre-exist, like, before that creator, and that there are other gods besides.
And that would be where the Greek dualistic concept would come into the Essene, the Gnostic concept of the immortality of the soul, which, you know, Pythagoras and those guys, you know, came up with, which is...
Well, I do think that the soul does have... There's not immortality, personally, because if a person does so much evil and their soul can only become so dark before it just stops existing.
Yeah, the Bible talks about the body, soul, and spirit, and the Bible says the soul that sinneth shall die. This, according to the Bible, the soul is really the essence of who a person is, their mind, their will, and their emotions. It is the spirit, that spark of divinity, which some people confuse the soul and spirit, which is actually, that's that divine essence. A person puts, it's the Bible looks at it and calls it the candle of the Lord, where they have a basic sense of morality, right or wrong, their conscience, if you will. As far as Psalm 82, it's about ye are gods. Yes, Jesus, Yeshua did quote that, but it says you shall die like men. In Psalm 82, you go a couple verses later. So, that shows that there were some Elohim, small e Elohim, that could die. And that takes us back to the Nephilim, and it takes us back to the death of the Nephilim in Genesis 6 at the flood. And those demons that rebelled are in Tartaru right now, waiting the judgment. So, there was a lot going on there in an interchange between Yeshua, Jesus, and the scribes and the Pharisees, whoever it was he was talking to, and Psalm 82. So he wasn't. There was a maybe double, triple entendre going in there.
What if we are the souls of gods and goddess, in my case, that are inside of a physical vessel, having an experience inside of the world that God created for us to all come into, to grow, to experience life, to learn, etc., all of that.
That would be an extra-biblical concept that comes out more out of Greek Platonism, not out of the Bible. And most of the religions, almost all the religions of the world, have some sort of a concept of that, except biblical, the true biblical religion, which that is a concept that came in. And the Essenes, as you, by your own acknowledgement, were a Gnostic sect, and the concept of gnosis, which then the concept of Gnosticism was put on to a lot of religious systems. There's Jewish Gnosticism, there's Christian Gnosticism, you know, you have the Greek Gnosticism, and we see Paul was addressing that in Colossians and several other things. So that was a system of kind of a hermetic, a metaphorical system. You've got that new thought and new age. You have that, you know, in all different kinds of permutations. What you follow is a Christian version. Freemasonry is a form of Gnosticism, if you study Freemasonry, especially for Helel.
The original Freemasons actually worshipped the grand architect of our realm, and unfortunately Satan has very, very corrupted that society.
Yeah, well, that, you go back and you look at what they taught originally, And they, you know, they go back to the knowledge of Enoch. But the question is, which Enoch? The Enoch that came from Seth or the Enoch that came from Cain? And one was evil and one was good. And there was the inversion again. Now, there's all kinds of interesting things. So that's why, you know, there's a lot of different strains and paths and things like that. And that's why it's, we get off the literal interpretation of Scripture and start to dip into other things, it can take us into all kinds of interesting places.
But who's to determine what Scripture? Because there's many scrolls that were found with the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Nag Hammadi Library that didn't get made into the 66-book-bound Bible, which is an interesting number, because 66 is not God's number.
Well, originally,
66 is one number away from 666.
That was the Jews who did that. So originally in the Old Testament, or the Tanakh, there were 22 books. One for each letter of the Hebrew alphabet. In other words, God is the beginning and the end. The Aleph and the Tav, or in Greek we say the Alpha and the Omega. Everything he said was in 22. And then along came the apostolic writings, which the New Testament calls, or which is called the testimony of Yeshua, the testimony of Jesus. That's a term that's used in the book of Revelation. And that added 27 more books to the Tanakh, so that was now 49.
Well, Paul's books are mainly about Paul, not anything to do with Christ, but that's a good reason.
No, that's not true. That's absolutely not true.
Paul is the first corrupter of the doctrines of the Christ.
Well,
he tried to kill James the Just, and he said that weak in faith eat only vegetables, knowing full well that the Christ was a vegan. Can you imagine calling the Christ weak in faith?
You cannot give me chapter and verse on that. That's extra biblical.
Like 1 Timothy 4 or 3.
No, he didn't try to. Well, that's, again, we could be here all day.
I've been down the rabbit hole very far. I grew up in this cult, so I know it. I've been teaching this stuff for
50 years, so I
yeah. But do you believe Genesis 1, that we live on a stationary plane underneath the dome?
I'm not going to get into flat earth foolishness.
I'm sorry, but you just discredited yourself by ignoring the first chapter of the Bible. I'm sorry to tell you, but you've literally discredited yourself to anyone who actually reads the Bible.
I have not, because right. people that...
Do you have any more questions?
People that try to take...
I'm not going to get involved with this because he just discredited himself regarding biblical cosmology. There are tons of verses that say that the Bible doesn't move, that we live under a dome, that there are four corners of the earth, and it's just...
Yes, I'm aware of all that, but that's poetic, metaphorical language. No, the Bible
is not
a book of science.
There's 666 all in the globe earth. You can deny it if you want, but I'm sorry to tell you, but from anybody who's actually researched it, you discredit yourself when you ignore the first chapter of the book. I've researched it, and again, it actually says that there were waters, and then the firmament was created in the midst of the land, then the land came up, and that's the land that we live on.
Right now,
the sun and moon were created as lights to move along around the earth, and the earth
I know we got Christians here, and I know we got you.
I don't know what I asked them. What side are you batting for, if I could be blunt?
Well, I wouldn't say that I'm batting for either, because I'm against the New World Order. I'm against Satanism, but I'm also against mainstream religion. So
you're here today for what reason?
I actually came to get footage, but none of the Luciferians even showed up.
Okay, so
Well, I actually wanted to talk to them, because I think that Lucifer is not who they think that Lucifer is. So I wanted to do this exact thing with somebody that actually was here for the event.
I don't follow any of the mainstream religions, but
I would say I follow more of the Essene Christ. Essene, E-S-S-E-N-E, and it was a sect of Jews that was against the animal sacrifices. They were against the mainstream religion push of it, and yeah, so a little bit different than both. I'm not really on any side of the argument. I came here to talk to anybody, actually. I have a pretty large following, and on the snow.
Sure. Maybe I better ask you one more question. If I want to put something about the snow, what I'm saying is your mission today.
Well, I actually came to bear the light in the darkness.
Bear the light in the darkness?
Yes, sir. But, well, I guess hopefully some people took
did,
to what
did
I
you
said
scare them off? I mean, I haven't seen one of the disciples here yet.
I don't know. I think that they might have scared the Bible people. Scared off. I'm not sure.
Bear the light. So you would have been, you were hoping to be able to talk to the disciples?
I was, actually. I wanted to talk to them and see what their perspective of the New World Order is. I'm personally against the New World Order. I'm against Satan personally. But interestingly enough, I think that Satan and Lucifer are not the same entity. So okay. That's kind of one thing that I wanted to talk to them about and figure out what they're all about, really. Well, I am here at the Capitol building, and as you can see, there are no Satanists behind me. Over here, we have some of the Jesus crew. But overall, nothing very exciting happened today except what I was involved in. I was the only Luciferian, true Lucifer, bearer of the light that showed up today. So it was well worth it. Proclaiming the truth of our reality from the Oregon State Capitol. I have not gone to church in a very, very long time. Pastors claim that they believe the Bible as the infallible word of God, but when you question them, when you ask them about the actual words in the Bible, they don't believe it. They say it's symbology or whatever other excuses that they use. On top of that, Genesis 1 also tells us the proper diet for the human body, which is raw herb and fruit-bearing seed. So, finding a flat earth, raw vegan pastor who also realizes that the Bible has been corrupted, that the original teachings of Christ have been hidden, is very, very hard. I've come to realize over time that I am the teacher. I am also a student as well. I am a student teacher. I am always trying to find the truth of our reality because no one is fully awake yet. It's not even possible, humanly possible, to know everything. I've never claimed to know everything. I'm always learning. If you don't learn something new every day, well, you could probably just give yourself an F in the book for that day. That might be a little bit harsh. But you get the point, is that you should constantly be learning and then using that wisdom that you learn to make your life better. When I learned that you can live for hundreds of years, then I came and told you that you can live for hundreds of years. But what good is that knowledge if we don't actually do the things required to live it out? We have to eat the right things. We have to do the raw vegan juicing. We have to do grounding. There are certain things that we have to do to implement that knowledge. But the point is that when I learn things, I tell you. I'm constantly learning. You're constantly learning. We're all constantly learning. But I will continue to relay, to teach the information that is given to me to you and to others, and together we can use that information to not only make our own personal lives better, but to help those that we love and to ultimately change the world. I am standing here in front of beautiful Mount Shasta, and coming up this week on July 4th will be my first full moon event of the season. I am really excited. I've got a whole bunch of delicious vegan foods that I'm going to be making and bringing up with me. So hopefully you are planning to come out and meet me on the mountain. I will be up there from sundown till sun up. So, hope that you can make it. I hope that you have a wonderful week. May God and the Goddess bless you.